This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The Khmer Rouge Killing Fields Khmer, Khmer pronunciation. 111 Genocide Question 112 Vietnamese 113 Chinese 114 Indigenous Peoples 115 Cham Muslims 12 Deaths 13 Mass Graves 14 International Reaction 15 Prosecution for Crimes Against Humanity and War Crimes 16 War Crimes Trials 161 Kong Kekiew 162 Nguyen Chi 163 Yang Seri 164 Yang Tirith 165 Q Samphan 17 Today 18 Denial. 19 In Literature and Media 20 See also 21 References 22 Bibliography 23 External links Background by the April 1975 Khmer Rouge victory, Pol Pot and his associates occupied the most important positions in the Communist Party of Kampuchea CPK and in the state hierarchies Pol Pot was known as Vacha Dumok or One with the Gun. He had been CPK General Secretary since February 1963. His associates functioned as the party's political bureau, and they held a majority of the seats on the Central Committee through the 1970s, and especially after mid-1975, the party was shaken by factional struggles, including armed attempts to topple Pol Pot. Punitive measures resulted in 1977 and 1978 when hundreds of thousands of people, including some of the most important CPK leaders, were executed, establishing the Constitution of Democratic Kampuchea. The Khmer Rouge abolished the Royal Government of National Union of Kampuchea established in 1970. Cambodia did not have any sort of government until the proclamation of the Constitution of Democratic Kampuchea on January 5, 1976. The Khmer Rouge continued to use King Norodom Sihanouk as a figurehead for the government until April 2, 1976, when Sihanouk resigned as head of state. Sihanouk remained under insecure house arrest in Phnom Penh, until late in the war with Vietnam when he departed for the United States, where he made Democratic Kampuchea's case before the Security Council. He eventually relocated to China. The rights and duties of the individual were briefly defined in Article 12. They included none of what are commonly regarded as guarantees of political human rights except the statement that men and women are equal in every respect. The document declared, however, that all workers and all peasants were masters of their factories and fields. An assertion that there is absolutely no unemployment in Democratic Kampuchea rings true in light of the regime's massive use of force. The Constitution defined Democratic Kampuchea's foreign policy principles in Article 21, the document's longest, in terms of independence, peace, neutrality, and non-alignment. It pledged the country's support to anti-imperialist struggles in the Third World in light of the regime's aggressive attacks against Vietnamese, Thai, and Lao territory during 1977 and 1978, the promise to maintain close and friendly relations with all countries sharing a common border bore little resemblance to reality. Governmental institutions were outlined very briefly in the Constitution. The legislature, the Kampuchean People's Representative Assembly KPRA, contained 250 members representing workers, peasants, and other working people and the Kampuchean Revolutionary Army. 150 KPRA seats were allocated for peasant representatives, 50, for the armed forces, and 50, for worker and other representatives. The legislature was to be popularly elected for a five-year term. Its first and only election was held on March 20, 1976. New people apparently were not allowed to participate. The executive branch of government also was chosen by the KPRA. It consisted of a state presidium responsible for representing the state of Democratic Kampuchea inside and outside the country. It served for a five-year term, and its president was head of state Q Samphan. Was the only person to serve in this office, which he assumed after Sihanouk's resignation. The judicial system was composed of people's courts, the judges for which were appointed by the KPRA, as was the executive branch. The constitution did not mention regional or local government institutions after assuming power. The Khmer Rouge abolished the old provinces Khet and replaced them with seven zones: the Northern Zone, Northeastern Zone, Northwestern Zone, Central Zone, Eastern Zone, Western Zone, and Southwestern Zone. There were also two other regional level units, the Kracha Special Region No. 505 and, until 1977, the Siem Reap Special Region No. 106. The zones were divided into Damban regions that were given numbers. Number 1, appropriately, encompassed the Samlot region of the northwestern zone, including Battambang province, where the insurrection against Sihanouk had erupted in early 1967. With this exception, the Damban appear to have been numbered arbitrarily. The Damban were divided into Srok districts, Kum subdistricts, and Pum villages, the latter usually containing several hundred people. This pattern was roughly similar to that which existed under Sihanouk and the Khmer Republic, but inhabitants of the villages were organized into Krom groups composed of 10 to 15 families on each level. Administration was directed by a three-person committee. Kanak, or Kena CPK members occupied committee posts at the higher levels. Sub-district and village committees were often staffed by local poor peasants, and, very rarely, by new people. Cooperatives Sahakor, similar in jurisdictional area to the Kum, assumed local government responsibilities in some areas. Ideology of Khmer Rouge ideology played an important role in the genocide. The desire of the KR to bring the nation back to a mythic past, the desire to stop aid from abroad from entering the nation, which in their eyes was a corrupting influence, the desire to restore the country to an agrarian society, and the manner in which they tried to implement this goal were all factors of the genocide. One KR leader said, it was for the purification of the populace that the killings began. Pol Pot and the KR forced virtually the entire population of Cambodia into mobile work teams. Michael Hunt said that it was an experiment in social mobilization unmatched in 20th century revolutions. The KR used an inhumane labor regime, instilled fear and terror in order to keep the population in line. Starvation, upheaval and resettlement, and collectivization of land. Ben Kiernan compares three genocides in history, the Armenian Genocide, the Holocaust and the Cambodian Genocide, which although unique shared certain common features. Racism is one and was a major part of the ideology of all three regimes. Although all three perpetrators were largely secular, they targeted religious minorities. All three also tried to use force of arms to expand into a contiguous heartland. Turkestan, Lebensraum, and Kampuchea Krom, all three regimes also idealized their ethnic peasantry as the true national class, the ethnic soil from which the new state grew. State terror under the Khmer Rouge. Remains of victims of the Khmer Rouge in the Kampong Track Cave, Kiri Sela Hills, Rung Tik Water Cave or Rung Kamau Dead Cave. A security apparatus called Santabal was part of the Khmer Rouge organizational structure. Well before April 17, 1975, when the Khmer Rouge took control over Cambodia, Sun Sen, later the Deputy Prime Minister for Defense of Democratic Kampuchea, was in charge of the Santabal, and in that capacity he appointed Comrade Dutch to run its security apparatus. When the Khmer Rouge took power in 1975, Dutch moved his headquarters to Phnom Penh and reported directly to Sun Sen. At that time, a small chapel in the capital was used to incarcerate the regime's prisoners, who totaled fewer than 200. In May 1976, Dutch moved his headquarters to its final location, a former high school known as Tuol Sleng, which could hold up to 1,500 prisoners. Skulls of Khmer Rouge victims. The Khmer Rouge government arrested, tortured and eventually executed anyone suspected of belonging to several categories of supposed enemies, anyone with connections to the former government or with foreign governments, professionals and intellectuals. In practice this included almost everyone with an education, people who understood a foreign language and even people who required glasses. Ironically and hypocritically, Pol Pot himself was a university-educated man, albeit a drop-out with a taste for French literature, and was also a fluent French speaker. Many artists, including musicians, writers and filmmakers were executed. Some like Rose Sarasuthia, Pan Ron and Shin Sisamut gained posthumous fame for their talents and are still popular with Khmers today. Ethnic Vietnamese, ethnic Chinese, ethnic Thai and other minorities in Eastern Highland. Cambodian Christians, most of whom were Catholic, and the Catholic Church in general, Muslims and the Buddhist monks, economic saboteurs. Many of the former urban dwellers who had not starved to death in the first place were deemed to be guilty by virtue of their lack of agricultural ability. The executed were buried in mass graves in order to save ammunition. The executions were often carried out using poison, spades or sharpened bamboo sticks. In some cases the children and infants of adult victims were killed by having their heads bashed against the trunks of Chongqing mulberry trees, and then were thrown into the pits alongside their parents. The rationale was to stop them growing up and taking revenge for their parents' deaths. Some victims were required to dig their own graves. Their weakness often meant that they were unable to dig very deep. The soldiers who carried out the executions were mostly young men or women from peasant families through the 1970s, and especially after mid-1975, the party was also shaken by factional struggles. There were even armed attempts to topple Pol Pot. The resultant purges reached a crest in 1977 and 1978 when thousands, including some important KCP leaders, were executed. Today, examples of the torture methods used by the Khmer Rouge can be seen at the Tuol Sleng Genocide Museum. The museum occupies the former grounds of a high school turned prison camp that was operated by Kang Kek Yu, more commonly known as Comrade Dutch. The torture system at Tuol Sleng was designed to make prisoners confess to whatever crimes they were charged with by their captors in their confessions. The prisoners were asked to describe their personal background if they were party members. They had to say when they joined the revolution and describe their work assignments in DK. Then the prisoners would relate their supposed treasonous activities in chronological order. The third section of the confession text described prisoners' thwarted conspiracies and supposed treasonous conversations. At the end, the confessions would list a string of traitors who were the prisoners' friends, colleagues, or acquaintances. Some lists contained over 100 names. People whose names were in the confession list were often called in for interrogation. Typical confessions ran into thousands of words in which the prisoner would interweave true events in their lives with imaginary accounts of their espionage activities for the CIA, the KGB, or Vietnam. Some 17,000 people passed through Tuol Sleng Center, also known as S-21, before they were taken to sites also known as the Killing Fields, outside Phnom Penh, such as Chung Ek, where most were executed mainly by pickaxes to save bullets and buried in mass graves. Of the thousands who entered Tuol Sleng, only 7 are known to have survived. Tuol Sleng was only one of some 196 prisons operated by the Khmer Rouge. Rooms of the Tuol Sleng Genocide Museum contain thousands of photos taken by the Khmer Rouge of their victims. The judicial process of the Khmer Rouge regime, for minor or political crimes, began with a warning from the ANCAR, the government of Cambodia under the regime. People receiving more than 2 warnings were sent for re-education, which meant near-certain death. People were often encouraged to confess to ANCAR their pre-revolutionary lifestyles and crimes, which usually included some kind of free market activity, having had contact with a foreign source, such as a U.S. missionary, international relief or government agency, or contact with any foreigner or with the outside world at all, being told that ANCAR would forgive them and wipe the slate clean. This meant being taken away to a place such as Tuol Sleng or Chung Ek for torture and or execution. Autogenocide. Autogenocide is the mass killing by a government or regime of a section of its own people. The term was coined in the latter half of the 1970s to describe the actions of the Khmer Rouge government of Cambodia, to distinguish such acts from the genocide of groups considered other by a government, such as the killing of Jews and people of Slavic origin by Nazi Germany. According to Samuel Totten, 25% of the urban Khmer population, 500,000 people, perished under the Khmer Rouge, while rural Khmers lost 16%, 825,000 of their population, putting the killing at a scale comparable to genocide of Roma. 25% of the Roma population of Europe, 130,000 to 500,000 people, and the genocide of Serbians, 300,000 Serbs during the Holocaust. Drawing the comparison to genocide aforementioned, many of those killed in Cambodia's autogenocide were killed due to the Khmer Rouge's economic policies. Societal transformation. According to Pol Pot, Cambodia was made up of 4 classes: peasants and workers, bourgeoisie, capitalists, and feudalists. Post-revolutionary society, as defined by the 1970s Constitution of Democratic Kampuchea, consisted of workers, peasants, and all other Kampuchean working people. No allowance was made for a transitional stage such as China's new democracy, in which patriotic landlord or bourgeois elements were permitted to play a role in socialist construction. Sihanouk writes that in 1975 he, Q. Samphan, and Q. Tirith went to visit Zhou Enlai, who was gravely ill. Zhou warned them not to attempt to achieve communism in a single step, as China had attempted in the late 1950s with the Great Leap Forward. Q. Samphan and Q. Tirith just smiled an incredulous and superior smile. Q. Samphan and Sun Sen later boasted to Sihanouk that "we will be the first nation to create a completely communist society without wasting time on intermediate steps." Although conditions varied from region to region, a situation that was, in part, a Reflection of factional divisions that still existed within the CPK during the 1970s. The testimony of refugees reveals that the most salient social division was between the politically suspect new people, those driven out of the towns after the communist victory, and the more reliable old people, the poor and lower middle class peasants who had remained in the countryside despite the ideological commitment to radical equality. CPK members and the armed forces constituted a clearly recognizable elite. The working class was a negligible factor because of the evacuation of the urban areas and the idling of most of the country's few factories. The one important working class group in pre-revolutionary Cambodia, laborers on large rubber plantations, traditionally had consisted mostly of Vietnamese emigrants and thus was politically suspect. The number of people, including refugees, living in the urban areas on the eve of the communist victory probably was somewhat more than 3 million, out of the total population of 84 million as mentioned. Despite their rural origin, the refugees were considered new people, that is, people unsympathetic to democratic Kampuchea. Some doubtless passed as old people after returning to their native villages, but the Khmer Rouge seem to have been extremely vigilant in recording and keeping track of the movements of families and of individuals. The lowest unit of social control, the Krom Group, consisted of 10 to 15 nuclear families whose activities were closely supervised by a three-person committee. The committee chairman was selected by the CPK. This grassroots leadership was required to note the social origin of each family under its jurisdiction and to report it to persons higher up in the Angkor hierarchy. The number of new people may initially have been as high as 25. Because of their age-old resentment of the urban and rural elites, many of the poorest peasants probably were sympathetic to Khmer Rouge goals in the early 1980s. Visiting Western journalists found that the issue of peasant support for the Khmer Rouge was an extremely sensitive subject that officials of the People's Republic of Kampuchea were not inclined to discuss. Although the southwestern zone was one original center of power of the Khmer Rouge, and cadres administered it with strict discipline, random executions were relatively rare, and new people were not persecuted if they had a cooperative attitude in the western zone. And in the northwestern zone, conditions were harsh. Starvation was general in the latter zone because cadres sent rice to Phnom Penh rather than distributing it to the local population in the northern zone. And in the central zone, there seem to have been more executions than there were victims of starvation. Little reliable information emerged on conditions in the northeastern zone, one of the most isolated parts of Cambodia on the surface. Society in democratic Kampuchea was strictly egalitarian. The Khmer language, like many in Southeast Asia, has a complex system of usages to define speakers' rank and social status. These usages were abandoned. People were encouraged to call each other friend, or comrade in Khmer, mit, and to avoid traditional signs of deference such as bowing or folding the hands in salutation. Language was transformed in other ways. The Khmer Rouge invented new terms. People were told they must forge Lot Dam, a new revolutionary character, that they were the instruments Apokar of the Angkor, and that nostalgia for pre-revolutionary times Chaheu Satek Arom, or memory sickness, could result in their receiving Angkor's invitation to be deindustrialized and to live in a concentration camp. Members and candidate members of the CPK, local level leaders of poor peasant background who collaborated with the Angkor, and members of the armed forces had a higher standard of living than the rest of the population. Refugees agree that, even during times of severe food shortage, members of the grassroots elite had adequate, if not luxurious, supplies of food. One refugee wrote that pretty new bamboo houses were built for Khmer Rouge cadres along the river in Phnom Penh. According to Craig Etchison, an authority on democratic Kampuchea, members of the Revolutionary Army lived in self-contained colonies, and they had a distinctive warrior caste ethos. Armed forces units personally loyal to Pol Pot, known as the Unconditional Divisions, were a privileged group within the military, although their revolutionary ideology was extreme. The highest ranks of the Khmer Rouge leadership had a tendency to nepotism similar of the Sihanouk era elite. Pol Pot's wife, Q. Poneri, was head of the Association of Democratic Khmer Women, and her younger sister, Q. Tirith, served as Minister of Social Action. These two women were considered among the half-dozen most powerful personalities in democratic Kampuchea. Sun Sen's wife, Yun Yat, served as Minister for Culture, Education and Learning. Several of Pol Pot's nephews and nieces were given jobs in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. One of Yeng Seri's daughters was appointed head of the Calmet Hospital, although she had not graduated from secondary school. A niece of Yeng Yang Seri was given a job as English translator for Radio Phnom Penh, although her fluency in the language was relative. Family ties were important, both because of the culture and because of the leadership's intense secretiveness and distrust of outsiders, especially of pro-Vietnamese communists. Different ministries, such as the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and the Ministry of Industry, were controlled and exploited by powerful Khmer Rouge families. Administering the diplomatic corps was regarded as an especially profitable fiefdom economy. Democratic Kampuchea's economic policy was similar to, and possibly inspired by, China's radical Great Leap Forward that carried out immediate collectivization of the Chinese countryside in 1958. During the early 1970s, the Khmer Rouge established mutual assistance groups in the areas they occupied. After 1973, these were organized into low-level cooperatives in which land and agricultural implements were lent by peasants to the community but remained their private property, high-level cooperatives, in which private property was abolished and the harvest became the collective property of the peasants, appeared in 1974. Communities, introduced in early 1976, were a more advanced form of high-level cooperative in which communal dining was instituted. State-owned farms also were established far more than the Chinese communists. The Khmer Rouge pursued the ideal of economic self-sufficiency, specifically the version that Q. Samphan had outlined in his 1959 doctoral dissertation. Currency was abolished, and domestic trade or commerce could be conducted only through barter. Rice, measured in tins, became the most important medium of exchange, although people also bartered gold, jewelry, and other personal possessions. Foreign trade was almost completely halted, though there was a limited revival in late 1976 and early 1977. China was the most important trading partner, but commerce amounting to a few million dollars was also conducted with France, the United Kingdom, and with the United States through a Hong Kong intermediary. From the Khmer Rouge perspective, the country was free of foreign economic domination for the first time in its 2000-year history by mobilizing the people into work brigades organized in a military fashion. The Khmer Rouge hoped to unleash the masses' productive forces. There was an Angkorian component to economic policy. That ancient kingdom had grown rich and powerful because it controlled extensive irrigation systems that produced surpluses of rice. Agriculture in modern Cambodia depended, for the most part, on seasonal rains by building a nationwide system of irrigation canals, dams, and reservoirs. The leadership believed it would be possible to produce rice on a year-round basis. It was the new people who suffered and sacrificed the most to complete these ambitious projects. Although the Khmer Rouge implemented an agriculture-first policy in order to achieve self-sufficiency, they were not, as some observers have argued, back to nature primitivists. Although the 1970-75 war and the evacuation of the cities had destroyed or idled most industry, small contingents of workers were allowed to return to the urban areas to reopen some plants like their Chinese counterparts. The Cambodian communists had great faith in the inventive power and the technical aptitude of the masses, and they constantly published reports of peasants adapting old mechanical parts to new uses. Similarly to Mao's regime, which had attempted unsuccessfully to build a new steel industry based on backyard furnaces during the Great Leap Forward, the Khmer Rouge sought to move industry to the countryside significantly. The seal of Democratic Kampuchea displayed not only sheaves of rice and irrigation sluices, but also a factory with smokestacks. Education and health. The Khmer Rouge regarded traditional education with undiluted hostility. After the fall of Phnom Penh, they executed thousands of teachers. Those who had been educators prior to 1975 survived by hiding their identities aside from teaching basic mathematical skills and literacy. The major goal of the new educational system was to instill revolutionary values in the young. For a regime at war with most of Cambodia's traditional values, this meant that it was necessary to create a gap between the values of the young and the values of the non-revolutionary old. The regime recruited children to spy on adults. The pliancy of the younger generation made them, in the Angkor's words, the dictatorial instrument of the party. In 1962, the communists had created a special secret organization, the Democratic Youth League, that, in the early 1970s, changed its name to the Communist Youth League of Kampuchea. Pol Pot considered Youth League alumni as his most loyal and reliable supporters, and used them to gain control of the central and of the regional CPK apparatus. The powerful Q. Tirith, Minister of Social Action, was responsible for directing the youth movement. Hardened young cadres, many little more than 12 years of age, were enthusiastic accomplices in some of the regime's worst atrocities. Sihanouk, who was kept under virtual house arrest in Phnom Penh between 1976 and 1978, wrote in War and Hope that his youthful guards having been separated from their families and given a thorough indoctrination, were encouraged to play cruel games involving the torture of animals having lost parents, siblings, and friends in the war and lacking the Buddhist values of their elders. The Khmer Rouge youth also lacked the inhibitions that would have dampened their zeal for revolutionary terror. Health facilities in the years 1975-1978 were abysmally poor. Many physicians either were executed or were prohibited from practicing. It appears that the party and the armed forces elite had access to Western medicine and to a system of hospitals that offered reasonable treatment, but ordinary people, especially new people, were expected to use traditional plant and herbal remedies that were of debatable usefulness. Some bartered their rice rations and personal possessions to obtain aspirin and other simple drugs. Evacuation of the cities. The deportations were one of the markers of the beginning of the Khmer Rouge rule. They demanded and then forced the people to leave the cities and live in the countryside. Phnom Penh, populated by 25. During the evacuation of Phnom Penh, even Phnom Penh's hospitals were emptied of their patients. The Khmer Rouge provided transportation for some of the aged and the disabled, and they set up stockpiles of food outside the city for the refugees. However, the supplies were inadequate to sustain the hundreds of thousands of people on the road. Even seriously injured hospital patients, many without any means of conveyance, were summarily forced to leave regardless of their condition. The foreign community, about 800 people, was quarantined in the French embassy compound, and by the end of the month the foreigners were taken by truck to the Thai border. Khmer women who were married to foreigners were allowed to accompany their husbands, but Khmer men were not permitted to leave with their foreign wives. Western historians claim that the motives were political, based on deep-rooted resentment of the cities. The Khmer Rouge was determined to turn the country into a nation of peasants in which the corruption and parasitism of city life would be completely uprooted. In addition, Pol Pot wanted to break up the enemy spy organizations that allegedly were based in the urban areas. Finally, it seems that Pol Pot and his hard-line associates on the CPK Political Bureau used the forced evacuations to gain control of the city's population and to weaken the position of their factional rivals within the Communist Party. Genocide of minorities. The communist Khmer Rouge regime arrested and eventually executed almost everyone suspected of connections with the former government or with foreign governments, as well as professionals and intellectuals. Ethnic Vietnamese, ethnic Thai, ethnic Chinese, ethnic Cham, Cambodian Christians, and the Buddhist monkhood were the demographic targets of persecution. As a result, Pol Pot has been described as a genocidal tyrant. Martin Shaw described the Cambodian genocide as the purest genocide of the Cold War era. Ethnic and religious victims. The Khmer Rouge regime targeted various ethnic groups during the genocide, forcibly relocating minority groups, and banned the use of minority languages. The Khmer Rouge banned by decree the existence of ethnic Chinese, Vietnamese, Muslim Cham, and 20 other minorities, which altogether constituted 15% of the population at the beginning of the Khmer Rouge's rule. Genocide question. In the Khmer Rouge's standing committee, four members were of Chinese ancestry, two Vietnamese, and two Khmers. Some observers argue that this mixed composition makes it difficult to argue that there was an intent to kill off minorities. To the contrary, R.J. Rummel, an analyst of political killings, argues that there was a clear genocidal intent. One estimate is that out of 40,000 to 60,000 monks, only between 800 and 1,000 survived to carry on their religion. We do know that of 2,680 monks in 8 monasteries, a mere 70 were alive as of 1979. As for the Buddhist temples that populated the landscape of Cambodia, the Khmer Rouge destroyed 95% of them, and turned the remaining few into warehouses or allocated them for some other degrading use. Amazingly, in the very short span of a year or so, the small gang of Khmer Rouge wiped out the center of Cambodian culture, its spiritual incarnation, its institutions as part of a planned genocide campaign. The Khmer Rouge sought out and killed other minorities, such as the Muslim Cham in the district of Kampong Xiem. For example, they demolished 5 Cham hamlets and reportedly massacred 20,000 that lived there. In the district of Kung Nice, only 4 Cham apparently survived out of some 20,000 Vietnamese. All 10,000 Vietnamese in Cambodia who were not already repatriated were killed by the Khmer Rouge. Chinese. The state of the Chinese Cambodians was described as the worst disaster ever to befall any ethnic Chinese community in Southeast Asia. Cambodians of Chinese descent were massacred by the Khmer Rouge under the justification that they used to exploit the Cambodian people. The Chinese were stereotyped as traitors and moneylenders, and therefore were associated with Capitalism among the Khmer, the Chinese were also resented for their lighter skin color and cultural differences. Hundreds of Chinese families were rounded up in 1978 and told that they were to be resettled, but were actually executed at the beginning of the Khmer Rouge's rule in 1975. There were 425,000 ethnic Chinese in Cambodia. By the end in 1979, there were 200,000 in addition to being a proscribed ethnic group by the government. The Chinese were predominantly city dwellers, making them vulnerable to the Khmer Rouge's revolutionary ruralism. The government of the People's Republic of China did not protest the killings of ethnic Chinese in Cambodia. The policies of the Khmer Rouge towards Sino-Cambodians seems puzzling in light of the fact that the two most powerful people in the regime and presumably the originators of the racist doctrine, Pol Pot and Nguyen Chi, both had mixed Chinese-Cambodian ancestry. Other senior figures in the Khmer Rouge state apparatus such as Sun Sen and Ta Mok also had Chinese ethnic heritage. Indigenous peoples in the late 1980s. Little was known of Khmer Rouge policies toward the tribal peoples of the northeast. The Khmer Low Pol Pot established an insurgent base in the tribal areas of Ratanakiri province in the early 1960s, and he may have had a substantial Khmer Low following predominantly animist peoples, with few ties to the Buddhist culture of the lowland Khmers. The Khmer Low had resented Sihanouk's attempts to civilize them. Cham Muslims under the leadership of Pol Pot, who was an ardent atheist, the Khmer Rouge had a policy of state atheism. All religions were banned, and the repression of adherents of Islam, Christianity, and Buddhism was extensive in addition. According to Ben Kiernan, the fiercest extermination campaign was directed against the ethnic Cham Muslim minority. Nearly 25,000 Buddhist monks were massacred by the regime. This attempt at the purification of Cambodian society along racial, social, and political lines led to the purging of the military and political leaders of the former regime, along with the leaders of industry, journalists, students, doctors and lawyers, as well as members of the Vietnamese and Chinese ethnic groups. The exact number of Cham people killed is unknown. However, according to survivors, there were an estimated 700,000 before the KR came to power, and there were an estimated 200,000 left following the genocide deaths. Ben Kiernan estimates that about 17 million people were killed. Researcher Craig Etchison of the Documentation Center of Cambodia suggests that the death toll was between 2 and 25 million, with a most likely figure of 22 million. After 5 years of researching some 20,000 grave sites, he concludes that these mass graves contain the remains of 1,386,734 victims of execution. A UN investigation reported 2 to 3 million dead, while UNICEF estimated 3 million. Had been killed. Demographic analysis by Patrick Hoiveline suggests that between 117 and 342 million Cambodians were killed, while Marek Slavinsky suggests that 18 million is a conservative figure. Even the Khmer Rouge acknowledged that 2 million had been killed, though they attributed those deaths to a subsequent Vietnamese invasion. By late 1979, UN and Red Cross officials were warning that another 225 million Cambodians faced death by starvation due to the near destruction of Cambodian society under the regime of ousted Prime Minister Pol Pot, who were saved by international aid after the Vietnamese invasion. Mass graves analysis of 20,000 mass grave sites by the DC CAM mapping program and Yale University indicate at least 1,386,734 victims of execution. Estimates of the total number of deaths resulting from Khmer Rouge policies, including disease and starvation, range from 17 to 25. In 1977, the book Cambodge Année Zéro, written by François Ponchaud, was released. Although the English translation was not published until 1978, Ponchaud was one of the first authors to bring the genocide to the world's attention. Ponchaud has said of the genocide that it was above all the translation into action, the particular vision of a man, a person who has been spoiled by a corrupt regime, cannot be reformed. He must be physically eliminated from the brotherhood of the pure. In 1977, Murder of a Gentle Land, The Untold Story of a Communist Genocide in Cambodia, written by John Barron and Anthony Paul, was published. The book drew on accounts from refugees, and after an abridged version was published in Reader's Digest, it was widely read in 1973. Kenneth M. Quinn, serving with the U.S. Embassy, had raised concerns over the atrocities being carried out in a report. He stated that the KR had much in common with those of totalitarian regimes in Nazi Germany and the Soviet Union. Opinion, Quinn has written of the KR that hat emerges as the explanation for the terror and violence that swept Cambodia during the 1970s is that a small group of alienated intellectuals, enraged by their perception of a totally corrupt society and imbued with a Maoist plan to create a pure socialist order in the shortest possible time, recruited extremely young, poor, and envious cadres, instructed them in harsh and brutal methods learned from Stalinist mentors, and used them to destroy physically the cultural underpinnings of the Khmer civilization and to impose a new society through purges, executions, and violence. The support of North Vietnam, in conjunction with China, was essential to the triumph of the KR in the Cambodian Civil War during the genocide. China was the main international patron of the KR, supplying more than 15,000 military advisors and most of their external aid as a result of Chinese and Western opposition to the Vietnamese invasion. The KR retained Cambodia's UN seat until 1982. China hosted KR military training camps from 1979 until at least 1986, and stationed military advisors with KR troops until as late as 1990. After the 1991 Paris Peace Accords, Thailand continued to allow KR guerrillas to trade and move across the Thai border, although criticism from the US and Australia caused it to disavow passing any direct military support. Ben Kiernan claimed that the US offered material support to the Khmer Rouge after the Vietnamese invasion. Other sources have disputed these claims. As of 2009, the Cambodian NGO Documentation Center of Cambodia has mapped some 23,745 mass graves containing approximately 1,386,734 suspected victims of execution. Execution is believed to account for roughly 60% of the full death toll. Prosecution for crimes against humanity and war crimes. In 1997, the Cambodian government asked for the UN's assistance in setting up a genocide tribunal. It took 9 years to agree to the shape and structure of the court, a hybrid of Cambodian and international laws. Before the judges were sworn in 2006, the investigating judges were presented with the names of five possible suspects by the prosecution on July 18, 2007. On September 19, 2007, Nguyen Chi, second in command of the Khmer Rouge and its most senior surviving member, was charged with war crimes and crimes against humanity. He faced Cambodian and foreign judges at the Special Genocide Tribunal and was convicted on 7 August 2014 and received a life sentence on July 26, 2010. Kong Keikiew, aka Comrade Dutch, director of the S-21 prison camp, was convicted of crimes against humanity and sentenced to 35 years imprisonment. His sentence was reduced to 19 years, as he had already spent 11 years in prison. On February 2, 2012, his sentence was extended to life imprisonment by the Extraordinary Chambers in the Courts of Cambodia War Crimes Trials. Main article, Khmer Rouge Tribunal. The tribunal's main building with the court room on 15 July 1979. Following the overthrow of the KR, the new government passed Decree Law No. 1. This allowed for the trial of Pol Pot and Yang Sary for the crime of genocide. They were given an American defense lawyer, Hope Stevens. They were tried in absentia and convicted of genocide in January 2001. The Cambodian National Assembly passed legislation to form a tribunal to try members of the KR regime. Such a tribunal was constituted as the Extraordinary Chambers in the Courts of Cambodia. The tribunal has been criticized for being slow, as only three people have been convicted among others tried by the tribunal, another died during his trial, and a fifth was found unfit to stand trial. Kong Keikiew, Kong Keikiew, known as Comrade Dutch or Hang Ping, was a mid-level leader of the KR regime. He set up the first Khmer prison code name M13 in Kampong Forest, where the prisoners had to live in pits. He set up another prison 2 years later, known as M99. It is estimated that up to 20,000 people were tortured and executed there following the Khmer Rouge victory in April 1975. The prison system was extended nationwide, and in Phnom Penh, the infamous Tuol Sleng prison, S21 prison, was founded. Dutch was in charge of the prison, together with his lieutenants Mam Nai and Tang Sin Hien, who led the torture and interrogation of prisoners. It is estimated that 16,000 people were killed within the Tuol Sleng compound, with only 7 known survivors. In 1999, Dutch was interviewed by Nick Dunlop and Nate Thayer, in which he admitted his guilt over the crimes carried out in Tuol Sleng. He expressed sorrow for his actions and stated he was willing to stand trial and give evidence against his former comrades on 16 February 2009. The Trial began, and he accepted that he was responsible for the crimes carried out at Tuol Sleng. On 31 March 2009, on 26 July 2010, he was found guilty on charges of crimes against humanity, torture and murder, and was given a sentence of 35 years imprisonment. On 3 February 2012, his previous sentence was replaced with life imprisonment. Nguyen Chi, on 19 September 2007, Nguyen Chi, known as Brother Number 2, was arrested, and later arraigned before the ECCC. At the end of the trial in 2013, he denied all charges, stating that he had not given orders to mistreat or kill people to deprive them of food or commit any genocide. He was convicted in 2014 and sentenced to life imprisonment. He has expressed remorse and accepted moral responsibility for the crimes, stating, "I would like to sincerely apologize to the public, the victims, the families, and all Cambodian people." Yang Sari was arrested on 17 November 2007 and charged with crimes against humanity. He died of heart failure in 2013 before his trial could reach a verdict. Yang Tirith was arrested on 12 November 2007 at the same time as her husband, Yang Sari. She was indicted on 10 September 2010, for crimes against humanity and genocide on 17 November 2011. Following evaluations from medical experts, she was found to be unfit to stand trial due to a mental condition. Q Samphan was arrested on 19 November 2007 and charged with crimes against humanity. He was convicted in 2014 and sentenced to life imprisonment. Today, the best known monument of the killing fields is at the village of Chung Ek today. It is the site of a Buddhist memorial to the victims, and Tuol Sleng has a museum commemorating the genocide. The memorial park at Chung Ek has been built around the mass graves of many thousands of victims, most of whom were executed after they had been transported from the S21 prison in Phnom Penh. The utmost respect is given to the victims of the massacres through signs and tribute sections throughout the park. Many dozens of mass graves are visible above ground, many which have not been excavated yet. Commonly, bones and clothing surface after heavy rainfalls due to the large number of bodies still buried in shallow mass graves. It is not uncommon to run across the bones or teeth of the victims scattered on the surface as one tours the memorial park. If these are found, visitors are asked to notify a memorial park officer or guide a survivor of the genocide. Dara Duong, founded the Killing Fields Museum in Seattle, Washington, U.S. Denial. Main article, Cambodian genocide denial. A few months before his death on 15 April 1998, Pol Pot was interviewed by Nate Thayer. During the interview, he stated that he had a clear conscience and denied being responsible for the genocide. Pol Pot asserted that he came to carry out the struggle, not to kill people. According to Alex Alvarez, Pol Pot portrayed himself as a misunderstood and unfairly vilified figure. In 2013, the Cambodian Prime Minister Hun Sen passed legislation which makes illegal the denial of the Cambodian genocide and other war crimes committed by the Khmer Rouge. The legislation was passed after comments by a member of the opposition, Kem Sokha, who is the deputy president of the Cambodian National Rescue Party. Sokha had stated that exhibits at Tuol Sleng were fabricated and that the artifacts had been faked by the Vietnamese following their invasion in 1979. Sokha's party have claimed that the comments have been taken out of context in literature and media. According to Deirdre Boyle, Rithi Pan, who is considered by many to be the cinematic voice of Cambodia, is himself a survivor of the Khmer Rouge's Killing Fields, arguably his best known and most affecting documentary as S21, The Khmer Rouge Killing Machine, in which he recuperates memory to represent speechless horror and thereby shatter silence with its unsettling reenactments. S21 allows us to observe how memory and time may collapse to render the past as present and by doing so reveal the ordinary face of evil. Long Ung recounted the genocide in her memoir First They Killed My Father 2000. The genocide is portrayed in the 1984 drama film The Killing Fields and Patricia McCormick's novel Never Fall Down 2012. The genocide is referenced satirically in the Dead Kennedys song Holiday in Cambodia. See also Alive in the Killing Fields, book Enemies of the People film First Indochina War First They Killed My Father, by Long Ung Sun Sen Ta Mok Vietnam War references Carrot Alvarez 2001, p. Carrot Hannum 1989, pp. The Holocaust. Columbia University Press, p. The Spectre of Genocide, Mass Murder in Historical Perspective. Cambridge University Press, pp. Littlefield, p.